It's been nearly 3 years since the signing of a law formally recognizing arnis as the national martial art and sport of the Philippines. Today, it's not only recognized as a training tool for the military and police, it has also been getting a push from Hollywood. Indeed, Filipino martial arts, or FMA, has become a global phenomenon. In hopes of preserving the legacy of arnis and Filipino martial arts, an advocate has put together The Bladed Hand, a documentary film that traces the beginning of arnis. And here to tell us more about his homage to the FMA is documentary producer, director, cameraman, and editor Jay Ignacio. Ikaw na ang lahat, Jay.
Lahat, lahat.
You've done it all talaga.
Yep.
But before we go into the documentary, let's talk about arnis. Okay. It became the national sport 3 years ago.
Declared as one.
Okay.
3 years ago.
Okay. Let's talk about the history a little bit. Where exactly it originated from? Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao. Tell us about it.
There are different paths that arnis took depending on which island group. So the most globalized forms of arnis or eskrima are from the Visayas.
Okay.
These are the most globalized. And in the case of the Visayas, back in the 1600s, when the islands were Christianized, they were often raided by Moro pirates from Mindanao.
Okay.
During monsoon season, you know. So the Jesuits who were stationed there felt they needed to enhance, seguro, the fighting of the natives, so they taught them their brand of fencing.
Okay.
So along with the existing fighting systems during that period, when they incorporated, when they blended with Spanish fencing, that became known as eskrima.
Okay, so the first, it wasn't arnis at first, it was eskrima. But
they're interchangeable.
Okay.
They mean the same thing.
And internationally, it's known as Kali.
Okay. They all mean the same thing.
Okay.
There are just stylistic differences within each.
And it's so funny that you know so much about it from this documentary just because of this documentary. You didn't have a personal association to arnis before. Because
no.
I thought you were part of that whole team because you have a lot of friends. Maybe maybe 10 to 20 years ago, they started Bakbakan.
Bakbakan was started a long time ago.
Right, right.
But my friends were in it in the 80s.
They got into it. And is arnis part of Bakbakan? Or?
Bakbakan incorporated the arnis style of the late Tatang Ilustrisimo.
Okay.
That was part of their curriculum.
Okay.
So anyone who went through the arnis program of Bakbakan took up Ilustrisimo.
But why did you decide to venture on this documentary where you're doing everything from 2009 to present? And you're still, obviously, you're going to promote it again, round two. But why did you start on it? I mean, it wasn't something that you were into.
Not
and yet
entirely,
you just, yeah.
Yeah,
you decided to take a dip. Why?
Well, when I found out the cultural value of arnis, that's when I felt compelled to tell the story. Because I heard a lot of stories over the years. Okay, this was used in this and that movie. Oh, okay. And then the military here in Germany or in the U.S. or Navy SEALs or Spetsnaz in Russia, they use this also. Parang, there must be something I'm overlooking or, you know, I need to dig further. And when I did further research on the subject, I realized that it's not just a martial art. It is actually... It has become one of our greatest cultural exports.
Correct.
Yeah.
And the thing is, though, at this point, a lot of the masters, they're called masters, right?
Yeah. Some are gurus, some are masters.
Gurus are masters. But a lot of them were very old when you started the documentary. And you were saying that four or five of them passed away in the interim.
From 2009, when I started production, to 2012, there were at least four famous ones who died. Two of them were based in Stockton, California.
Okay.
And the other two were based here.
And how do you pass that on? Because more than, we were saying a while ago, that it's less systematic and really more of traditional in terms of passing it on. Because there's no, like let's say in Taekwondo, there's obviously there are rules.
Yes.
And people already know the styles or the hits, the punches. With arnis, it's a little more free-flowing. And how do you pass it on properly? Like, obviously, these masters have passed on. Who did they pass on the legacy to?
The masters, when they have kids who also study with them,
lifestyle na yun,
it
no?
Usually, yeah, more often than not, automatically gets passed on to them.
Mm-hmm.
For those who don't have heirs, it's their most senior students who carry on the tradition. Some of the senior students, you know, when the master passes, they kind of go on their own,
mm-hmm.
and then their own, they put their own interpretation into it, and then they change the name.
But then that doesn't really preserve
the
actual spirit of it, does it?
If the new master acknowledges the roots, then
you
have something continuing pa.
Okay. So let's talk about the cardinal rules in arnis. I mean, obviously you didn't quite do it, yet you lived it for 3 years because you were exposed to these masters, you were exposed to a lot of their students. What would you say the cardinal rules are?
Well, if we're talking about the sport, I'm not familiar with the rulings. In fact, ever since they declared it a law,
mm-hmm.
they've had several meetings where they were trying to unify. I said they're different leagues.
Oo nga.
So they're trying to unify all these rules. So I have yet to hear from them what has actually come up or what has been done. In terms of teacher-student relationship, I think the most important thing for the view.
Okay. So respect.
Respect.
Mm-mm.
Yeah. It's a different martial art compared to the more popular ones like Taekwondo, Karate, even BJJ, where there's a systematic, there's a definite ranking and
mm-mm,
things
mm-mm.
like that. So you have to be a certain level to associate with this guy or, you know, but for arnis, it's very personal. So it's just, you know, kung kasundo mo yung teacher mo, yun, okay yun. If you wanna go on your own, the teacher would be happy to be acknowledged.
Right.
That you came from him.
But I think arnis is also, more than anything, it looks aggressive, but it's not, because it's really more of an art form with respect for each other.
That's
as opponents.
That's the modern evolution of it, but but the origin, in the early days,
yes,
it was a survival
defense mechanism.
It was a defense and a survival method.
Right.
So you know, many occasions it was kill or be killed.
That's true, pero not naman in modern day.
No, but because we've gone past that.
Right.
So the modern evolution of it is yun, meron na tayong ini-instill na discipline,
mm-mm,
and there are systems put in place na rin to keep everything in order, or you have levels of learning.
Correct.
Oh.
So may system kahit papano.
Yeah, meron na.
Okay.
I mean, they'll teach you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and all that. So that in itself is a system.
But back to the documentary, though. I saw bits of it on YouTube, which is
yeah.
good. You used social media as an avenue to maybe reach...
Everything we've done, I mean, to advertise it, has been through Facebook and YouTube.
Do you have a Twitter and Facebook account for it?
Twitter is @TheBladedHand.
Okay. Do you feel that it helped you guys a lot in terms of disseminating information?
Very much, because we just concluded our first U.S. screening tour.
Right.
I was in the U.S. for 2 months.
How did you get it there?
Through Facebook, because I announced that I was going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
We arranged 2 screenings on our own,
okay.
So where we made arrangements with the theaters, and we rented them, and then I said, okay, I'm going to be in the U.S. for 2 months. I told the followers, you know, if you want to host a screening, I'm in the U.S. Let me know, diba. So that's how it happened. So from the 2 screenings, the first one was LA, and then a week later was San Diego. Dumami na naging 8 city tour.
But who exactly went to watch? Were they arnis specialists? Were they just really interested that it was a Filipino film? Who exactly were the people that
surprisingly, it was a very mixed audience.
Really?
Not just the martial arts enthusiasts.
Really?
Of course they were there.
Mm-hmm.
But there were a lot of people who heard of it through social media, and they wanted to see something about the Philippines.
Okay.
So we had a very eclectic audience, actually. There were teachers, university professors who showed up. Businessmen, indie film enthusiasts who didn't know anything about FMA or the Philippines. They just wanted to see an indie film.
So in terms of making the documentary, because obviously you've showed it and you're going to do a second run next year.
Yeah.
Hopefully the Philippines as well. Have you showed it already here?
I did a few times, but it's more difficult actually to get it screened here.
And you'd think, in your own country.
Yeah. So
maybe after today, you'll get
some
calls.
Yeah, hopefully.
In terms of doing the documentary, you did everything by yourself?
Yes.
I mean, obviously,
mostly.
In the beginning, yes.
I did all the interviewing, all the camera work, because I couldn't afford to pay a crew, you know. So I did everything myself.
But in terms of funding, did you have to travel a lot?
I did.
Did you have lighting at all? Or
no,
was it just really...
I was a slave to available light.
Okay, so during the day yung mga interview
yeah,
mo.
Yeah, and one of the cameras that I used was more light sensitive, so I could shoot in slightly darker settings if need be.
And in terms of interviewing the people, what did you learn? You also interviewed, did you interview a Russian or a German? I saw snippets of it.
I interviewed a German master, his name is Dieter Knutel.
And who was his master?
Both Remy and Ernesto Presas.
And how did these people all get together, or how did they meet? Did the German come here and learn the art form here?
Yes, he came here. I think he learned first from the Presas brothers when they were going abroad, because the Presas brothers would do seminars around the world.
Okay.
So I'm not so sure how he got started with them, but he has been coming here regularly. And in fact, he was the one who organized the first FMA international gathering for their Modern Arnis group.
Okay.
The first two were held in Germany, and then the rest have been held here. So some of the scenes that I filmed in Palawan were from that gathering.
And it's not only in terms of the Russians use Arnis as well, but Hollywood.
Yeah.
Hollywood
uses
it a lot.
Yeah.
Maybe you can mention some of the movies that I'm sure a lot of people have already seen. They just didn't realize that the art form they were using was Filipino.
All the Bourne movies, all four.
Okay.
The first three were done by one man. His name's Jeff Imada, whom I interviewed. And he's a senior, one of the senior students of Dan Inosanto. Dan Inosanto was the partner of Bruce Lee in developing Jeet Kune Do.
Wow.
Yeah, and he taught Bruce Lee Filipino martial arts and the Chako.
There's so much history here, see?
There's a lot,
It's good that you've put it to light, and hopefully other people who are actually embedded in the world of Arnis can also help do something about it.
Sana. Diba? That's one of the goals that I had for the film. People will become more aware of it and would... hopefully inspire them to look back into our history and our culture. Because really, this has been embraced by the rest of the world.
Right.
Whereas here, we even had to go to lengths to declare it our own.
Yeah.
As our own. So.
And it took a long time. I mean, 3 years
too
ago.
Too much time.
Although Arnis has been around for centuries, obviously.
Yeah. The man who really wanted, who dreamt that it would become a law, didn't even live to see it become one. His name was Roland Dantes.
When did he pass on?
March 2009.
The same year?
Yes. It was only a couple of months after that when I decided to make the film. So I didn't get to meet him.
So people out there who want to try Arnis, what are the elements, do you think, from all of the people that you interviewed, and I'm sure you've seen a lot of people practice it, what are the elements to making a good, I guess, Arnis student or Arnis master?
Wow. In terms of being a student, go to your classes with an open mind.
Okay.
Because you may have your own idea of how to move, but do what the teacher tells you. And then, you know, have your own interpretation privately. But when you're there, you know, do what he gives you, tells you to do. As a teacher, I think, Arnis is a very person-to-person kind of thing. as long as you're friends, you have a good relationship, that's what matters. A teacher will be more effective if he is.
I guess if you're open.
Not a rigid disciplinarian.
Okay. Kala ko kailangan rigid because obviously with a lot of martial arts, it's all about that. It's all about rules and discipline and.
But culturally, we're very laid back.
We're quite free flowing, actually.
So a strict teacher, someone who is very feared, usually ends up with less students.
Correct.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Well, you're busy now because you're planning your next leg of tours for 2013. Tell us about that.
We are arranging something more comprehensive because what happened in the last one was only two were actually planned and all the rest were...
And you ended up having eight or so, which is good.
12 screenings in eight cities.
Eight plus. That's really good. And how did they, again, through Twitter and Facebook, they
Everything
found out about
through
it?
Through Twitter and Facebook.
And was it easy? Did they set it up for you and you just had to come in with a reel? How did it work out?
Yeah, basically I said, you know, if you want a screening, I will show up. I will bring the DVD with me and, you know, press play.
Well, that's good.
We're not commercially releasing the film until maybe the middle of 2013.
And where are you doing that at first? In the
States, we're doing self-distribution.
Okay.
So we'll find an avenue. It will be through our website, which isn't up yet, but
But at this point, if people want to go online and check it out, where can they go? Give us your Facebook and Twitter handles.
Yes, the Facebook page, you just type, it's a number, kasi, so just type The Bladed Hand on the search window of Facebook and join the group.
Okay.
I put all the updates there regularly. And then for Twitter, it's at The Bladed Hand, one word.
Okay, and finally, again, you said it a while ago, but talk to the audience about what they have to take away from watching The Bladed Hand.
First, let us be aware that we have arnis as something that gives us a cultural identity. A lot of us are in search of who we are. This is one thing. I think more than any of our indigenous arts, this is the most distinct and the most globally embraced. So we are recognized for this. So we should also recognize ourselves for that. The other thing is it is our greatest cultural export. And hopefully that will make people look back into our culture and our history to see the value of something like this. The martial arts are not just a fighting art. They have a significant cultural relevance.
Okay. Well, Jay Ignacio, thank you so much for
being
with us on the holiday.
Thank you for having me.
Enjoy a few days off. You deserve it.
You too.
Okay. And I'm going to watch The Bladed Hand for sure. Congratulations.
Thank you.